And welcome back to the Chapel of the Atonement on a wonderful spring afternoon. And what could be better than to warm ourselves up with the joy and delight of some organ music? I'm Ned Cheryl, I'm the head of the school, and about a year and a half ago, as we were getting started on conversations about the centennial and what we'd like to do to commemorate 100 years of life and love and caring on this wonderful campus, one of the first things that came to mind was to have a conversation with Gary Gress, our organist, about the possibility of an organ concert, of doing something special here in this wonderful building with its true treasure, this Aeolian Moller organ, which you'll hear more about. But it was Gary's design to invite former school organists to come back and join us. And we're delighted that they have said yes to that. And again, I'll let Gary introduce each of them in turn. I think that's his privilege and right to sort of do that. But we're honored by their ability and willingness to come and be with us and to share this wonderful gift of the school. The chapel itself is 90 years old, 10 years younger than the school, built 10 years into the school's history, and it ended right as where the transepts begin. And it was extended in the 1960s, and the organ was also extended and sort of aggrandized at that particular time. And it's really one of the true gifts, not just of the school, but I think of our certainly surrounding area. There's some wonderful instruments, but in the intimacy of this particular space and of our particular campus and the mission of the school, I think that you'll find that this afternoon's concert to be a true delight and joy, not just a gift to the senses, but also a continuing prayer to God of the continuing work of this wonderful school. We're glad that you're here, and I hope that despite a little bit of dreary weather, that you'll make your way after the concert just to the east. There's a little pathway across the lawn that'll get to the driveway that leads to the head of school residence. We'd love to have you for a small reception to meet and greet our guest artists as well as Gary. Have a little chance to sort of commune together before heading off again into the day. But without further ado, I'll turn it over to Gary and our wonderful artists. Again, thank you so much for being here this afternoon. Welcome.
Good afternoon. I too would like to welcome you to Church Farm School. This idea came, as Ned said, for me, actually, the actual core ideas came somewhere during the summer when I started seriously thinking about how to make this a special event. And I want to thank Ray Greenblatt, who I reached out to, who gave me a list of all the organists who had been here under his time as an English teacher here for 40 plus years. Ray gave me a list of 8 names, and I was able to find 7 of them. You can imagine trying to find it on Google search John Williams, that all you find would be film score music at that time. Not an organist, so I'm not sure John. But I was able to contact everybody else, and out of that, I was able to actually have conversations with 4 of them. I'm so grateful for Bill Fenimore, Michael Stairs, and Tony Ciucci for just being so open to coming back and doing this. I'm very excited to have you here. Unfortunately, Ken Rowe is unable to make it today, so we will forego that portion of the event. This, sitting here in front of you is really a 60-year history of the organ here and organists at Church Farm School. To me, it's really very exciting because, believe it or not, that's older than I am. And my students don't believe that, I know, but it really is. And the school has changed quite a bit in 60 years, but some things happened. And the position that the 4 of us have held here is a very special one at Church Farm School. And we have all had the choirs here. It's not the same anymore. When Bill was here, and I'm sure he'll say a little bit, the school was 5th grade through high school, and he had the pleasure of working with unchanged voices. And today I have 9th and 12th graders in just high school boys. Exciting, but very different. But there are some other things that have been in common, and that is this instrument. And even though, again, Bill will tell you about what it was like for him here, but this Moller, with some of the ailings still in the back, has been a wonderful addition to the school and the community of Church Farm School, all boys who come here. And what I found when I was talking to them at a variety of levels was I found something that I found nowhere else in the world. There's a brotherhood of men who understand the intricacies of the Christmas pageant. And it absorbs one's life from the end of Thanksgiving until the middle of December, and nobody but these gentlemen truly understand what that was like, what it is like. And so that was a wonderful gift for me in coming together with these guys today. So the format really today is to ask each of them to just put a few pieces together. So it's about the music, but it's also allowing them time to give some walking down memory lane and giving some experiences of their time at Church Farm School. So I hope you enjoy this celebration. So I'd first like to welcome up Bill Fenimore.
Thank you. Save my remarks until after the music, but I really can't play this piece without something. I was here when, before this, and I'll talk to you about that later, but when the organ, the Moller Aeolian, was finished in 1963, world famous Dr. Virgil Fox came here to play the dedicatory recital, and the place was packed. Incredible experience for all of us. Dr. Schreiner, the founder, sat right over there. At the end, Virgil played this piece. I hope now he's smiling down. when Gary asked me to play, he also wanted me to share with him some experience during my time here. And to do this, we'd have to go back a total of 59 years. It was September of 1959. I was just entering my first year at Curtis in Philadelphia, where my organ teacher told me that the Church Farm School, I'd never heard of it, needed an organist, and I should pack an overnight bag and he could take me to the Paley Local. Well, I was met at the Paley Local Station, the Paley Station with the Farm School wagon. I was dropped off on the south side of Lincoln Highway, down the hill from this chapel. The driver of the station wagon told me that he thought maybe that's where I needed to be going, but he wasn't sure. I should point out that I was 19 years old at the time, and I looked like one of the students here. So up the hill I went, opened the front door, walked in. Oh, the sun was coming through these windows, not these, these right here, the windows back there. And I saw this organ. I hope you can hear me. I've got to go down here for this. The organ console was right underneath that pulpit. And I turned around and saw these wonderful pipes. Wow, no one was here though. And the console was open, just like the front door. Aha. So I thought, well, I think I can get away with this. I've got to hear that organ. So I sat on the bench and I was looking for the switch to turn it on when I heard, "Hey, what are you doing? Where are you supposed to be?" And that was the voice of Earl B. Wilkins, who some of you may know, of Earl Wilkins. He was serving at that time as master of the day, and he wanted to know what this kid was up to. So I introduced myself to him, and he explained to me then that I needed to be talking to the rector at St. Paul's down the highway. In those days, St. Paul's Sunday choral music was provided by the Church Farm School Boy Choir. We rehearsed Saturday evenings in the basement of Greystock Hall, and then walked east on the highway. There was hardly any traffic back then, to sing at the church every Sunday morning. After a few weeks out here, I was called in to meet Dr. Schreiner, the founder of the school, who amazingly enough knew that I was raised on a farm and came from a broken home. He was, how shall I say it, stern. But he also had a reassuring twinkle in his eye that put me at ease, but I would never tell him that. The Colonel, as he was affectionately called, shared his dreams of enlarging this chapel, expanding seating at the pageants, a new organ, the boy choir singing here on Sundays, weekly chapel services with choir and organ. And at that point, I was fortunate in being told to oversee the proposals for the new organ. Imagine that, a young organist speaking with the major organ builders of the day, designing an organ for this place. The Colonel and I established music appreciation classes in the school, a concert series featuring Curtis students, even an opera by Noel called The Telephone, and this is, you have to get this, which included the singing of the telephone number of the dining hall payphone, which was used by the farm school boys to call home and certain female friends, perhaps. At the end of the opera, the soprano sings, and I don't know the notes, but Foxtrot, or don't forget my number. Write it down. It's Foxtrot 3, which is 3-6-3-7-5-0-0. And at that point, the entire hall just broke up. To this day, that's still the number, isn't it? Yeah.
5-0-0,
yes. Yep. Okay. To this day, I continue to be grateful to Dr. Schreiner, founder, the Colonel, for sharing his dreams and encouraging me to be a part of them back then, supporting my work here. And it was a sad day in 1964 when I played for the Colonel's funeral. I promised to be brief, but I want to add one.
next on the agenda is an adjustable bench. would very much like to welcome the next Mr. Michael Stairs. Michael, do you want to say anything? The Church of Farm School. It's very near and dear to me. And I'm so excited that the head of school and Gary have asked us to come and play this program. I think my 2 years here were incredibly wonderful. My first year, I had fifth graders and sixth graders, and they sat across the way there, although you could hardly see them in the working console. But it's all right, they made lots of sound. it was amazing. They sang with all of their heart and soul. The wonderful things I remember about this place is the Rose Garden. The Rose Garden was where the boys wanted to meet to talk over personal things and anniversaries of perhaps their dad dying. And the Rose Garden had every kind of rose you could think of, but some that you couldn't. And I think some were invented here, but a talk, when the lads wanted to talk in the Rose Garden, you knew that it was a very special kind of thing. The singing here was extraordinary. I got to learn every hymn in the Episcopal hymnal, because every time the headmaster sneezed, we had chapel. The wealth of hymns that I know from the old hymnal are very heartwarming. I had the pleasure of working in the fields in the summer. That was a delightful option offered to certain faculty. It was a good way to augment your income. But hefting the bales into the truck on a hot day was something else. But this maybe is the stone in this room. In the evening, there was always cool up here. And this beautiful instrument was always solid. So I could talk for a long time, but I won't. And if you've got any questions, you have a lot of history right here in this room. And I'm glad that I know so many of you for so many years. This is extraordinary. So anyway, I'm just playing two numbers. We're going to France first. I'm playing Couperin as listed. But for the second number, I decided to make it a little more fun, and I'm playing something called the Dam Busters, which I play a lot downtown at the store. But it has to do with World War II and the fact that by busting the dams, the Allies achieved a lot of victory. But this is by Eric Coates, and just fun to play, and I think fun for a rainy afternoon. Hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
going to say anything today, but sitting back there listening to this music and seeing friends and thinking back over 35 years ago, I think is when I came here, and the organ, obviously, who wouldn't want to play this organ on a regular basis? It's an organist's dream to play an organ of this caliber. It's just magnificent, it's versatile, plays everything. Things to say, and I'll probably forget a couple, but I do want to mention that many of you I do not know, but some of you I do, and I'm so happy to see Bill and Jenny Sanderson and their daughter Katie and Ray Greenblatt. They were here in the days when I was here. And it's nice to see my colleagues, Michael Stairs, Gary, and Bill. Just looking back, memories, you have memories. I can think of a few things, a few highlights of my time here. We did concerts, choral concerts with the boys. At that time, it was seventh grade and up, so there weren't too many unchanged voices, but we did combine with other schools, in particular, whenever there were girls involved, it motivated the boys to participate. And another thing we did, the Philadelphia Orchestra had student concerts in those days, and that was fun. The boys enjoyed going in there. And there was one trip that we took one year. We would take these trips with the kids. They had to sign up. And I think Ed of the school mentioned the name Roger Bowen. And he was chaplain there at one time. It was before my time, but I knew him. And at that time, he had gone to Washington Cathedral. And I contacted him, and he said, yes, bring your band and come down. So he treated us very well. Gave us a tour of the Washington Cathedral, and then we had time to wander around DC. So that was a good memory. I did not know that Virgil Fox dedicated this organ. All my years, I never knew that. But when I was a kid in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, growing up, Virgil came and played at the Forum. The Forum is part of the state educational complex in Harrisburg, in the Capitol complex. And I was there, I heard him play, I got his autograph, I got his picture. And so I didn't know the connection with this place, but I think I'm just gonna play now. The first piece I'm playing is by Keith Chapman, and that's a Philadelphia name. He was at Wanamaker's. He was the organist there until his untimely death. He was a pilot, and he and his wife had an accident, I believe, in the Rockies. And that's how he died. And the second piece I'll play is by a British composer, Noel Rawsthorne. It's an arrangement of a very familiar tune. Noel Rawsthorne is, I believe, at Liverpool Cathedral, or maybe he's no longer there, but he was there for quite a while. Thank you.
simplest auditions ever. Terry, the grandson of the founder, said, could you play him for me? I'm like, I guess I can do that. So I did that. I got the job. Maybe you should have interviewed me further. I don't know. But what I do remember when I walked in here was, first of all, the amazing space. And, of course, the instrument. And it's really what convinced me. Plus, I gave the money. I was right out of college. But the beauty of this chapel has never ceased to impress me. And that's not just me. The Architectural Digest just recently featured Church Farm School in its top 50 youthful campuses, one for each state. And we somehow received that honor for Pennsylvania, and primarily because of the chapel. And if you've never been in here in either the morning when the sun rises on this side, which I have very often been, or when the sun sets on this side, there's just this amazing golden glow that comes into this building and transports you to another world. And then on top of that, you have this instrument in front of you, and you just create this amazing experience. It's just a very, very, very special place. You might not know these facts. It also has created drawn nature to itself. Animals love this instrument. There was a summer when the windows were open and the birds enjoyed that, especially if you're inside and flying around as well. And I didn't know that it could be a death trap, but it actually happened that one of the birds got caught in the antiphonal pipes, the facade in the front, and actually Lizette pointed it out to me several years back. There was a skull of a bird pointing out one of the pipes back there. I felt really bad for it, but it was kind of made by that. The other point of nature was several years back when we still had leather work and it was an electro-pneumatic system up here in the console, the leather attracted the mice. And there was one particular Sunday I remember coming in here and that mouse had never found its way out, but it sure left its mark from an olfactory perspective. I did not play the organ that week. It's also created a somewhat of a love-hate relationship for me, almost 90%, 99% love, I should say. But at this moment, when this instrument has just created all kinds of interesting events, up to about a week ago, when I thought that the blower was going to freeze on us, and there was a crisis there, do we have to go on the concert or not? That was averted. And again, on Friday, when a third of the organ went down electronically, and that was averted as well. So I'm hoping it will last for at least another 12 minutes. That being said, an instrument that is now 55 years old, it requires maintenance. And first of all, I'm grateful to the Schreiner family from the beginning, through Terry, who had the vision to put this kind of instrument in here, and when it was expanded to continue that tradition, and the benefactors who support the instrument, and continue to this day to Med, who values the instrument and the upkeep that requires. It could easily be allowed to fall into disrepair, and it is not. I mean, there are things that need to be done, and we're in the exciting phases of continuing the upkeep of the instrument, but I'm very, very grateful to Med for continuing that tradition and supporting this instrument. The pieces that I'll be playing are two organ transcriptions by Sir Edward Elgar, the Enigma variation from the Nimrod from